When I was a kid, I used to dream what it would be like to live somewhere far away from Hell's Kitchen. Somewhere beautiful. I realized that the city was a part of me, that it was in my blood. I would do anything to make it a better place.
If he had an iron suit or a magic hammer, maybe that would explain why you keep getting your asses handed to you.
I'm not seeking penance for what I've done, Father. And I'm asking forgiveness for what I'm about to do.
Welcome back to episode 15 of Defenders TV Podcast, the podcast about the Netflix shows Daredevil, Luke Cage, aka Jessica Jones, and Iron Fist, all leading to the miniseries Defenders. I'm sure I'm going to miss one of those one week. I'm one of your defenders. I'm Derek, Laura by day, Defender by night.
I'm Irene, the Unbreakable Cage.
I'm Chris, aka Jessica Jones, but only on the weekend.
Hi, I'm John. I am the Iron Fist, also known as Danny Rand.
Hey guys, how are we doing after this episode?
Well, this was a bit more chilled, a bit more relaxed, a bit more sedate in how it went, and so I was quite pleased by that. The other one was, if you've listened to our epic podcast number 14, which of course you can download at defenderstvpodcast.com/iTunes or any other good podcast catcher. You know, that was jam-packed. It was a big episode, the previous episode. This one kind of pairs it back a bit, which is nice, I think. It focuses very much on intimate moments and between characters, and it's a bit sad and melancholy as well, I think, this episode. It's like,
it's a good time to let all the news sink in, and you know, everybody seemed a bit down.
Yeah, my bottom lip was shaking quite a lot, really, on this one.
Don't say that!
And I guess with that, we're going to get on to our full discussion. This time we're talking about episode 10 of Daredevil, Nelson vs. Murdock, written by Luke Kalteux and directed by Farren Blackburn. John, would you like to give us your synopsis of this episode?
I certainly will. Daredevil, episode 10, Best Friends for Never.
With the uncovering of the mass vigilante's identity by Foggy Nelson, the friendship between Matt Murdock and Foggy is put under the microscope and dissected. As Foggy feels hollow and utterly used and betrayed, can he trust anything Matt says or how he behaves? Is he even blind? All this disruption in their friendship proves too much for Foggy Nelson as he walks out of Matt's apartment. Events also increasingly begin to burden Ben Urich, as the situation with his wife and their health insurance weigh heavily on the choices he has to make. In the end, he must give up his pursuit of his King of Diamonds. However, Karen relentlessly tries to keep Ben invested in their cause as she uncovers an unexpected person from Fisk's past. Meanwhile, following Nobu's death, Fisk is concerned with Madame Gao's view on this evolving situation for the crime syndicate. But as he sends Leyland to mediate with Gao, a new and unknown enemy of Fisk surfaces, as a close confidant of Fisk is in mortal danger from a glass of tainted champagne.
Good stuff, good stuff. Irene, do you want to kick us off with your first point?
I'm going to start with the big thing, which is Foggy and Matt.
Yeah.
I thought Foggy was a bit hard on him. Like, I understand he's really hurt, and obviously he gets that across to him. He feels betrayed. He feels like everything's been a lie since they've known each other.
Yeah.
But I thought, like, he even said himself at one point, if you weren't half dead, I'd kick your ass. And you're like, but he is. And you're standing there shouting at him while he's half dead and he's in a lot of pain. And he's still your friend. Like, he hasn't done anything to you.
Apart from lie, like, for his whole life.
Yeah, I just thought it was a bit harsh. I thought he was unrelenting in his anger at Matt. There was no bit where he said, look, I can kind of see your point with this, but, you know, there was no but. There was just a, this is wrong, like, what are you doing?
Yeah.
And you've been lying to me. You've known I was lying to you. Made some really bizarre arguments like we're lawyers. I thought that was really funny when he said about you listen to her heartbeat without her permission. What the hell? We're lawyers. That isn't supposed to happen. I was like, where's that written down?
Yeah, it's like you've done a really intimate act with her that she didn't know about. You're encroaching on her personal space or something is the way it's coming across. But yeah, I'm sure there's no law against listening to someone else's heartbeat. But
it's never come up, I'd say.
Yeah, I'm sure they haven't developed a law for that yet.
That was a strange line. I think I actually have dumb lines of this episode. I mean, I like this episode, but there were maybe three lines that were said. It seemed a bit weird to be honest, and that was definitely one of them. And I was like, okay, I can't imagine this is the first law of law.
Lawring.
Well, the Superhuman Registration Act, it does make them say, I'm pretty sure that's in there, do not listen to someone's heartbeat.
I like it.
He said, you knew any time I was lying to you that I was lying. He said, well, how often did you lie to him?
I know. I did like that
line.
You're
not a great friend yourself then, are you?
Yeah. I did like that line, though, because there is that thing of, you know, with your friends, you probably have moments of just little white lies here and there, but knowing that somebody else knows everything that's going on in your mind is a little creepy and embarrassing. It must be a strange moment. Definitely these scenes obviously form the lion's share of the episode, really, are the scenes between Nelson and Murdock. So the episode title is pretty darn good, really. It is Nelson versus Murdock, and does kind of feel like a court case where both of them are pleading their side of the argument a bit. Matt is absolutely pleading his innocence to Nelson, hoping that he's not going to, you know, sentence him to no longer be friends anymore and break up the friendship. And we don't really know whether Nelson has taken this on board throughout the episode, but as you say, he is very much closed down to the idea of receiving an answer that's justifiable from Matt. He's very much setting up the whole argument as, you lied to me and lied to me for years. I'm not going to accept anything you're saying to me at all, Matt.
Yeah.
Which is an interesting way of dealing with this huge issue for the two characters.
Yeah, it's kind of one of my points actually follows from what Iron said, because it is pretty unrelenting, the whole Foggy bashing Matt as he's sort of lying there injured. But I think it was also just really bittersweet. It's the way it links back to their past. And I mean, not to sound cliched, but to happier times. Like, I loved them walking along the path saying, you're the only person that calls me blind Matt Murdock. Everyone else calls me Matt Murdock. There's all these, you know, we should be studying. It's very normal. It's relaxed. It's happy. They're laughing. It's even where we then move forward in those flashbacks, and you have the whole napkin scene where he writes, you know, Nelson and Murdock, attorneys at law, on the napkin, and they're having a drink, and it's like this kind of solidarity of the two of them going to set up this practice that does look out for the little guy, isn't the big law firm that it is just with corporate clients pursuing the little man. That, you know, they want to do something different. And all that, for me, was just tinged with sort of this bittersweet aspect, a sadness to it, because it contrasted so much with the pain of being lied to for so long for Foggy. And almost then, as you say, that law type of dialogue between the two of them, of Matt Murdock having to defend himself to the person who he has called his friend, and Foggy having to challenge him as to, has anything been real, to the person who only the other day was his friend. So it made all the flashbacks. It added a tinge of sadness to them. You know, a lot of tissues needed here, I think.
You see, at the end where Matt gets upset first.
Yeah.
And usually Foggy, you would have thought, would have been the softer one. Matt didn't get upset when Elena died, but Foggy was crying.
Yeah.
Like, not just upset, he was crying. But he didn't, actually, he's got a very hard face when they show Matt getting upset, and then it goes back to Foggy, and his face is just set.
Yeah.
It's just, no, there is no, and he just leaves.
Yeah.
And Matt can't follow him. Like, he can't run after him.
Mm-hmm. Probably can't walk at the moment. Very hard, yeah. He's pretty badly in a pretty bad way, really, as poor old Matt. Yeah, I know what you mean. There's definitely a lot more emotion here with Matt, and it is quite difficult for, as as we said, it's a very emotional episode. It's quite difficult to watch Matt break down as he loses his friend. But the response from Foggy is very much, all I wanted from you was to be a friend. That's all I wanted. And you've now told me that basically every part of our relationship was a lie from when we were in college, when you introduced me as the blind guy who couldn't see and had me drag you around everywhere and carry you around to everywhere we were going. So yeah, I'm kind of on the side of Nelson on this one. You know, I know it's a superhero show, and I know there's always in the comic books there has to be a persona where he doesn't tell any of his friends or family about it, but I don't think Matt explained away well enough why he was doing that, to protect the people around him, which is the usual excuse that's given, that you don't want anybody to know, because if people find out, then they're going to be victimized by your enemies. Gave no explanation like that. He just kind of said, well, I really didn't come up in conversation over the last 5 years, and I didn't really get an opportunity to tell you I'm sorry, basically, and you would have done the same if you were wearing a mask. Never tell somebody else what they're going to say to you, or else you're going to get that kind of reaction as Foggy gave in this episode, I thought. Yeah. Chris, do you want to give us your first point?
Sure. I'm going to bring up perhaps the point we've all been waiting for. The love interest, mm-hmm. the beautiful Jennifer Garner. I hope not. Nope. No, of course, in this episode, in a flashback scene when Foggy and Matt are walking down through the college campus, Foggy reminisces about, so what about that smoking hot Greek girl mm-hmm. that you followed into Spanish class? Mm-hmm. This has to be a direct reference to the lovely Electra, mm-hmm. who is perhaps one of the most pivotal characters in the Daredevil lore series in the comic books. And please, any of our listeners, do not take, if you've never read many of the comic books and you're just going by the 2003 film, that is an okay... No, okay, it's not. It's an okay representation. But Electra is pivotal to Matt, mm-hmm. And especially his growth as the... So I'm expecting now that was the... We'll get the Greek girl from college comes back in season two, mm-hmm. and that's where we're going to get a full introduction. She also was trained by Stick. Mm-hmm. She's fought for the Hand. She's a mercenary. She fights for the good guys and the bad guys, and double crosses the bad guys and double crosses the good guys. Amazing character.
Yeah.
And this was a great piece for me. It was just like, yay!
Yeah, nice little reference to Electra Nachos. There's nachos, isn't it?
Yeah, nachos. Yeah,
not nachos, like I used to call them.
No, those Doritos, remember?
Oh, yeah. Or Pringles on a Wednesday.
Yes.
Yeah. good catch there, definitely. And I think we'd actually said a couple of times after episodes before that it's weird they don't have any references to Electra, so it's nice to see a reference, veiled though it is, that this could be Electra.
Yeah, I think obviously Stephen DeKnight and the other writers were very cautious
mm-hmm.
About how not to be too associated with the original film.
Mm.
I think that was just from both that the films were had pluses and minuses in both, pros and cons in both categories.
Mm-hmm.
The spin-off, the Electra film, stunk, unfortunately, but it had some good scenes.
I don't remember any good scenes,
actually. If you squint and just kind of turn your head to the side yeah, and then yawn, it's like, that's the good scene.
It's like lime-flavored nachos. It didn't work.
Yeah.
and on that weird taste sensation.
So, Derek, what's your first point?
Madame Gao and Fisk's meeting. I wanted to just talk just a little element in there. It was actually just about her story to Fisk, which I just thought was a really interesting jab at who Fisk is and how he's being perceived by Madame Gao. Essentially, the story of the snake and the elephant in the village. Snake opens its mouth too wide, trying to take down an elephant, and is found dead with its mouth wide open. And I like that Fisk's response to this is, am I the snake or elephant in that story? Which am I? Am I the one that you're going to try to take down, or am I the one that's trying to take on too much of New York? Gao is a fascinating character. I love her on screen in every episode she's been in so far. This one is another wonderful, threatening of Fisk from the small old woman who isn't taking out any weapons, isn't attacking him with her vast army of people. She is just simply threatening and dangerous.
Not even shouting.
Not even raising her voice, absolutely. No. Yeah, I thought it was a really, really good scene.
Old women rock, definitely. That was also one of my points as well. And like the whole scene, the rooftop garden, you know, it's very zen almost, but just with all the skyscrapers around was like so cool looking, so awesome. And then you have this really measured dialogue, yeah, the snake and the elephant story, this idea that like she gives a little bit of history as well. When you came to me as a younger man, you had this singular vision and you've now become conflicted. You know, you can't be both light and shadow, savior and oppressor. You have to make a choice here. That was really cool for me. I thought, again, just this beatdown of Wilson just through tales and stories. And it was really great to see. I thought it was really good seeing this. Loved it, yeah.
Yeah.
And I have to say, Vincent D'Onofrio's Mandarin, my God.
Seems phenomenal.
It seems phenomenal. I don't know if he actually learned Mandarin or he can speak Mandarin, but the inflections, it doesn't look like he doesn't portray it that he was just an actor who learned sounds.
Right.
He sounds like he actually, when you look at it, it sounds like he does know what he's saying.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's a testament. Actually, a really nice Marvel Easter egg, that rooftop, Spider-Man 1, Sam Raimi.
Yeah.
When Peter Parker, as Spider-Man, saves Mary Jane and flies her and drops her into that garden.
Oh, right. Very interesting.
That's why it looks familiar.
Very interesting.
It's been in loads of other films. Yeah. And it's obviously quite well known for filming. But that was just a bit, oh, it's a Marvel crossover kind of thing.
Nice one. Yeah, we were pretty close to there when we were in New York last time. Hopefully when we get back to New York, we'll go and visit all the locations where both Daredevil and Gotham were shot.
Just not Hell's Kitchen.
Maybe. Hell's Kitchen's actually a lovely area of New York. Lincoln is the area. It's a lovely area of New York, actually. Yeah. One of them. I think it's actually some of the highest rents are in that area of New York now because it has been redeveled quite well. But not in this year.
Fisk's just succeeded then.
Fisk may have succeeded. Sugar. I've just given away the end of the first season of Daredevil. No, essentially what Marvel have done with the show, I think we actually may have mentioned this on our first episode, but what Marvel have actually done is said that the Battle of New York has destroyed a lot of the Hell's Kitchen area and kind of pushed it back to tenements and pushed it back to a really destroyed place. And that's why it's kind of mirroring what Hell's Kitchen would have been like in the 70s because the attack on New York has destroyed some of the areas, basically. So it's a good choice by Marvel there. Irene, do you want to give us your next point?
When Karen calls, when Foggy is still talking to Matt, and when Foggy told her that Matt had been in an accident.
Yeah.
That was my, if any moment did it, that was my bottom lip quivering moment.
Because
he still didn't give him away. That was the only bit I went, okay, maybe he's not all bad then, because he didn't give it away. But then on the other side, I was going, Jesus, poor Karen. Like, you ring up looking for the two guys you work with, they haven't turned up, and you're told one of them was in an accident.
Mm-hmm.
And
don't come over.
And hilariously, she said, was Matt driving? No, he wasn't driving.
Dumb line number two, I think.
I thought that was a funny line, I must
say. Yeah, I don't know. I took it. I know how you mean. You can take it funny,
I know she had. She did show him a newspaper last week to get his opinion of what was on the front page. But I liked the little kind of reaction seemed quite well placed. I think she's probably just taken aback by the fact that she's being told over the phone that her best friend or one of her best friends has just been in a car accident that she didn't know about.
Yeah.
And kind of went, okay, well, he's blind. If he's driving the car, I can see why he was in an accident. You know? But I thought it was
nice. Scent of a woman or scent of a daredevil.
There you go, scent of a daredevil. Yeah.
But basically, Irene, what you're saying and what you want to say to Foggy is, how many fingers am I holding up in this episode? And I love that opening as well. Just the, are you even blind? I mean, it's such a great question straight off the bat that you would ask after sort of uncovering your blind friend who can do all this kick-ass stuff. It's brilliant. I loved it.
Really good. Chris, do you want to give us your next point?
Yeah, I'm going to just do, I think we touched on it briefly before, and there's the scene with Ben Urich and his editor, where he's being offered a new associate editor, assistant editor position.
Yeah.
Straight away, what caught my eye again was the clippings mm-hmm. on the back. So we had known from previous kind of interpretations or what we gleaned that Ben had made his mark doing these kind of big scandal corruption pieces.
Yeah.
And then the Battle of New York piece got him a huge byline. Obviously, that's referring to the Avengers.
Mm-hmm.
And then there was Terror in Harlem. Again, that was on the wall. I'm assuming that's... We see a photo of the Hulk, I think, and yep. the Abomination. So, Incredible Hulk.
That's right, yeah.
But there was one more.
Uh-huh. Interesting.
And now I want to see what... I'm looking for feedback from my listeners, right? Uh-huh. Because I have a theory, but I just want to see. It's caught cheating.
Okay.
Hmm. What playboy philanthropist could end up on page one uh-huh. With caught cheating?
Interesting. So, is that Tony Stark?
Maybe. Is it Tony Stark and his love life back in original days? From did Ben do a bit of glossy mag coverage around Tony Stark and from the original, the very first Iron Man before he became Iron Man?
Maybe.
But I'd love to see what other people think. Yeah, okay. Who was caught?
Who was caught cheating? That's an interesting question, definitely.
Derek, what's your next point?
It's one for me, really, that stood out in this show. We've talked about the realism of the show quite a lot, obviously, and what they're doing. But one that really stood out to me in this episode was finally we have someone talking about their job quite realistically in this episode of Ben Urich. I've seen so many TV shows over the years where, you know, people work through the night, not sleep, because their jobs are the most important things around them. Ben Urich's character here is finally saying, you know what, sometimes things aren't as important as your job. He's supposed to be the reporter character in this TV show, which means this is supposed to be the most important thing for him. In this episode, it's showing that essentially his wife's dying. That's much more important to him than the central story arc of this TV show that he's a part of. And I thought it was nice, because it's nice to see a well-developed character with real things going on in their life around them. The storyline itself with Ben's wife is a very sad story. His wife has obviously got dementia of some sort, or Alzheimer's of some sort potentially. The beautiful scene between the two of them in the hospital where she wakes up and they have a proper conversation and everything seems fine. She seems lucid. Hello, handsome. Hello,
gorgeous.
Hello, gorgeous. Yeah, lovely scene between the two of them, and then it starts over again when the Alzheimer's kicks in. Tough scene to watch, I thought.
Horrible, yeah. And that look passed across her face, and you're going, God, she's gone.
Mid-kiss as well. Yeah. That was the bit that got me. If it was like end just of talking, kiss, and then
yeah.
it would have been reset, but it was the mid-kiss, and you could see it. They did it really, the shot was beautiful. Mm-hmm. It was slightly askew, but you saw her eyes kind of, who's doing what to me? And yeah. I was like, oh, it's
heartbreaking.
It was so touching, like, just their whole interaction, and then just tragic at that moment, where it's just really sad. Mm-hmm. It's definitely, yeah.
And just,
such
just
a great little scene.
And because that scene was played so well, and because Ben Urich's character is the character he is, I like that he's taken this on board and said, and brought the box of his investigation to Karen and said, look, this is for you to investigate now. I'm out. I can't deal with this and the issues with my wife anymore.
Yeah, like his line is, I know how important it is, when he was speaking to Karen, but it's not the most important to me. And a really good line. And actually, when you kind of thought that Karen was trying to persuade him otherwise, I was kind of slightly, I felt a bit antagonized by Karen just mm-hmm. continually pursuing it, because he has made this quite important and personal decision,
yeah.
very emotional, to, you know, maybe take on the editorship because it provides for more money to be able to put his wife into a hospice, a normal real life kind of consideration that people would do. And just for that moment, I mean, I know it's to drive the story, and I mean, you know, it's not that it's colored anything towards Karen's character as that stage, but it does, the writing does the job to really kind of make you go, no, Karen, just let him be, kind of thing. If we don't push your point, like, we understand why it's important.
That's the kind of thing you decide lightly. So.
But it's great writing to actually push those triggers on the basis of everything that's gone before, and I love that aspect to it as well.
Yeah.
I wonder, I know this is speculation, but I wonder, are they, because we now know Spider-Man, the Spider-Man deal would have been done end of filming
mm-hmm.
of this, are they potentially pulling Urich out. I think winding down his story or his part of it to either put him into a Spider-Man situation or worse, because he's that crossover, maybe just try and get rid of him.
Right.
Like, just because he is that, he's too connected to both universes. So could it be that they're winding, just trying to wind down, and we may get a cameo in season two?
Maybe.
Kind of thing.
Maybe. I'm not sure. I'm really not sure. It's difficult to watch the show and realize that the whole thing was dropped in one day. Now we're almost a month on from when it was released. Now, and it's difficult to think of it in that way, that it was all dropped in one day. Time hasn't passed for the show like it does for most shows that are on TV. Yeah. So realistically, the deal with Marvel and Sony was only probably done 3 months before the show was released. Looking at some of the episodes that we've seen with the makeup effects, the fighting, the filming, the editing that had to be done, I presume this show was actually fully in the can before the deal was actually done. With Sony, I think it was done probably about November, December last year, which is interesting that they may have made that decision to pull them back, knowing something was coming up there. But
okay, well then, based on what we know of the writers now,
mm-hmm.
and how much they like violence, tugging on our heartstrings,
yeah.
are they building Urich up in our minds,
mm-hmm.
and our love of him, only to tear him down?
To rip him away. I know, I don't want to even think about that.
Yeah, but, no, but it's the thing, they seem to do that. This seems to be the way. They're building up all these characters, and we don't know. They could go Game of Thrones style and just mm-hmm. start, like, axing people left, right, and center.
Yeah. It's interesting, and I having been hugely complimentary of what they did with Ben in this episode, I get a sneaking suspicion that Karen's ploy to bring him to meet Mrs. Fisk, I guess we can call her now, will actually convince Ben to go back and start investigating again. And I've been hugely complimentary with how they've dealt with Ben's story in this episode. And I'm not so complimentary about what Karen did to bring him to meet Mrs. Fisk and reignite the interest in the story, because that wasn't the issue. He was not interested in the story. No. He was just saying, there's more important things in my life. So I'm thinking probably next episode we'll have Ben back to investigating the story. For some reason. But let's see. I'll reserve my actual judgment on that piece until I see it, obviously. But on that note, John, do you want to give us your next point?
Yeah, my next point is, she's alive! She's alive! Wilson Fisk's mom's alive.
Yeah.
And had three husbands after her rotter of a first husband.
And then a gay husband.
Then a gay husband.
And then a really nice one.
And then a really nice one, yeah. And this is... this is really good. This is a really nice little sort of surprise, a jack-in-the-box within the story that she's there and she's, in a sense, going to spill the beans about her lovely Wilson. It wasn't his fault, and begins to just draw out that story that we saw in Shadows in the Glass, and really sort of pulls and starts to bring out all those elements that we saw in Shadows in the Glass, the you know, the Wilson Fisk origin with the young Wilson killing his dad and all that potentially about to explode. And I love how that gets brought out in this intimate setting of a bedroom in a hospice, and then it sort of opens out to this grand space where Wilson Fisk is about to sort of speak to a load of donors, I think, and guests at this function that he's set up. I love that contrast of where he is now and where his mum is at the moment, who we all thought had died, wasn't it? I think earlier on in the episode they say that she had died a year after her husband had gone missing and so on. So it was a good reveal, I thought, and it really kind of explodes the can, I think, really.
Mm-hmm.
That's really weird. And just thinking about that, a year after, so that would have put Fisk as what, 13, 14?
About that, yeah.
So how did he hide his mother's... So, yeah, that's just, okay, possibly a potential kind of plot hole.
Let's see because we're probably going to hear more of this story as we go on.
Okay,
what we have a bit of knowledge of from the comic books is the connection with Rigoletto, one of the crime bosses in Hell's Kitchen. There's possibly been some cover up that's been done here. Most of the neighborhood didn't seem to like the Fisk family, very much because of his father. When he went missing, they assumed that Rigoletto had killed the father. There could be another connection there that hid his mother's past from people outside of Hell's Kitchen, perhaps something like that. But Karen traced it down, so obviously the hiding work that was done wasn't that great. No. I guess
because she's no Ben. Actually, apparently she's better than Ben.
Uh-huh. Yeah,
interesting.
Yeah, a really good scene. Really interesting. I was totally thrown off balance on this. I thought Karen was doing something really nice. I thought there was going to be some really nice point here for Karen, where she was going to reveal to Ben that actually she was the heir to a huge fortune, and she was going to pay for his wife to come and stay in this amazing place. This is why she was bringing him here.
Parents ran it or something.
Something like that. Or that it was her mother that was staying there. And this is how nice life in a hospice can be if you get into the right one. I thought she was doing a nice bit of service for Ben. But as I said, unfortunately, the character isn't on her mind. What she wants to do is convince Ben to keep working with her and keep investigating into this Wilson Fisk to save the city of Hell's Kitchen.
So it was pretty despicable.
Mm. Yeah, I was.
Because he made the heartfelt explanation to her that it's not the most important thing in my mind right now. If she took that in any way lightly, or if she took it that his decision was made any way lightly, it's really insensitive.
Yeah.
Like, it's not all about you, love. Like.
Yeah, no, it is. It actually puts her in a really manipulative, uncaring kind of light, I think, because he even goes, you know, oh, we've gone into the wrong room, sorry about this.
And she keeps keeping it.
And it's so premeditated
that
she didn't need to actually drag him out to that place. Because she couldn't have known that Wilson Fisk's mum was going to say those things unless she knew them already to prompt her in the questioning. So they didn't need to drive out there. So it was all a false hope. To an extent, and he now realizes that. So it'd be interesting to see his reaction to her, because I think any normal person would probably just
tell you where to go.
And it'll be interesting what happens in the next episode. But it really puts her in a, as I said,
it's very bad light.
She's ideological now at this stage, and nothing else matters.
Fanatical almost.
About other people's well-being and their emotions. It's no longer about anything other than her obsession and her drive to bring down Fisk for something that's still... This is maybe the first bit of real evidence that she has. Yeah. She could have told him in the office.
Yeah.
But on the drive out, all the stuff she's saying to him about, you know, you just have to swim through the shit and hope you don't swallow too much. Like... Mm-hmm. You're going, well, if you're really that jaded, then how are you so naive and blinkered about going after this really powerful man?
Yeah.
He's just a rich bad guy. But if you're really, you're not that jaded, like what, and then bringing Ben out there, I don't know, I just thought it's actually really cold when you think about it. Like you're bringing him away from his wife that he's just decided to spend time with.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. I think in any other show, it would actually work if it wasn't put in these circumstances. Again, if he hadn't said specifically, I understand why this is so important to you. I understand why it's so important to the city, but right now this is not what I should be focusing on.
Yeah.
I think that's allowed. I think people are allowed to say that occasionally. All right, you guys can continue fighting. I'll even give you everything I've done already, so you're not falling behind because I'm not involved anymore. But for her to do what she did, I thought was cold. Yeah, definitely.
I think we spoke about it in some of the earlier episodes of the podcast, about earlier episodes.
Mm.
They are very much, she was the victim at the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
And the more we're getting introduced to her, the more we see that she is self-destructive, that she does not care about other people. They are setting her up for... That you do not like her.
Mm-hmm.
And it's becoming more and more evident. So she's self-deluded. It's centering around her.
Yeah.
She's taken...
Totally.
She is literally now... she is going to destroy lives based on her own passion to take down the Kingpin. And she doesn't have the same level of charisma as... Ben or the legal smarts as the other people. She as Foggy.
The skills or the knowledge she thinks she does either. Yeah. It's like, I was fine with her being self-destructive because I don't like her. But don't start hurting other people now.
Yeah. She's the evil within. She's actually this kind of rotten core that's beginning to infect out into the sort of the other members of, the group.
Just because Matt and Foggy forgave you for being sweet and a bit thick doesn't mean everybody else has to. Yeah.
Well, I do like Ben's description of it, essentially. It's basically, I like your tenacity. It reminds me of me when I was younger. I like that you get things done. But what you need to learn is that sometimes you have to step away and sometimes you don't force things. You need to learn how not to force things with people, essentially. She's just done it to him, though.
Yeah.
So she clearly hasn't learned that lesson. On that point, Chris, do you want to give us your next point?
I'm going to bring up the fundraising scene.
Okay, yep.
Yes, yep. So that was... Well, I want to bring it up for a number of reasons, but I'll get quickly to the point.
What's going on? Yeah.
What's going on? Mm-hmm. B, again, we see Fisk as this political powerhouse. He's more and more becoming to learn how to control the crowd. He's talking to senators. Mm-hmm. He's doing the whole elbow shake hands.
Yes.
He is, literally, you just needed the baby, as we said before, the baby with the camera, and he picks the baby, kisses it, and hands it back to the mother.
Yeah.
It was like he's becoming this really well-oiled machine. What I liked is that we're introduced to Senator Sherry, who is, again, from the comic books.
Right.
He's actually from Frank Miller's Daredevil.
Right.
Surprise, surprise. Mm-hmm. And he's they refer to him as the simpering slave.
Right.
He's corrupt, official. Daredevil takes him down, as they do.
Mm-hmm.
But that was a nice kind of, again, nod back to Frank Miller's.
Mm-hmm.
Owsley has a really fun mention of a Van Lunt who is obsessed with astrology.
Right.
This is a hugely obscure reference.
Yeah, I was wondering about that.
A ridiculous supervillain called Taurus.
Okay.
Who gets his power from astrology.
Right.
He's kind of like the owl.
Right.
He's just like, he's a throwback from the 60s, or the early 60s, 70s. And you're like, okay, we can just, that was a joke and a nod. I don't understand why.
I wonder, was he a member of the Scorpio gang as well? I wonder about that. But
Surely. Surely he must have been.
Taurus, I'm sure.
But the best one that I loved was the throwaway remark by Owsley, which is actually a nod to the Defenders comic book,
right,
which he talks about, make sure Richmond's on the guest list. He won't come, but he'll get pissy if he isn't invited.
Right.
This refers to Kyle Richmond,
okay,
who is Nighthawk in the comic books.
Right.
For our listeners who aren't aware of some of the original Defenders lineup,
mm-hmm,
Nighthawk and the Defenders were sometimes set up as this alternative to the Justice League,
right,
by Marvel. Nighthawk is Batman, Marvel's version of Batman. He's a billionaire playboy. Originally, he was a billionaire playboy. He got annoyed. He had bad luck in his boarding school and stuff. So he ended up becoming a vigilante for the hell of it.
Right.
He has this terrible costume in black with red hood, mm-hmm, with actual peak, looks like a beak.
Right.
He has...
kind of like Hawkeye.
Yeah. And he has wings. He actually has wings and a jetpack that flies him around. His worst power, which he gets later, he gets slightly stronger from Dusk Till Dawn. So it was just a nice throwback to, obviously, he's in the Defenders.
Mm-hmm.
They could throw in a reference because it was a gala dinner and they went, okay, let's make it nice.
Right.
But yeah, that was, it was really, for me, that was nice. I don't think we're ever going to see him on screen.
Right.
If we do, it'll be season 4.
Right. We've run out of characters season 4.
Let's go put him in.
like Arrow season 3. Sorry.
But no, it's good. And I think the key point to this was the ending.
Yes.
The choking.
Absolutely.
The foaming, the arsenic, perhaps?
Possibly, yeah, yeah. I'm really intrigued by this one, definitely.
Who did it?
Gao? Is Gao enacting her threat? That was absolutely the point that I'd written down about this episode. Is Gao enacting the threat that she laid out for Wilson? He has to make a choice here. Either be a leader either be a leader or take care of your girl, essentially. And now his girl is lying on the floor choking, and
yeah,
and he either has to show his leadership skills or take her to hospital, basically. So what's going to happen here?
Yeah, and even just the link to Leyland Owsley as well, who he comes in and says, it's sorted. But then it was how he behaves where he obviously hasn't drank any of the champagne mm-hmm. and drops it as well, as though he is aware of what's going on slightly. I'm not entirely sure whether I maybe saw that correctly, but for me, it hinted that maybe he is involved in it to some extent, because he has increasingly challenged Fisk sort of at Potter's tailors. You know, he really starts to challenge Fisk in terms of, you're not getting this sorted, you know, things are unraveling. And it happened again in I think it must have been Fisk's apartment, where Owsley is there. And I have to say, I was half expecting Fisk to break his neck or push him out the window or hit him or punch him or just kill him in that scene. And Fisk asks him to go and talk to Madame Gao to try and smooth things over. There's obviously a slight fracturing going on. We've had it with the Russians and now with Nobu as well. And Owsley has just been more and more antagonistic towards Fisk. Mm-hmm. And I wonder whether, we don't know because it was off screen, but he's gone back to Madame Gao to say, look, I've been asked to do this. I'm getting more and more concerned about how he's behaving. We've seen her in the roof garden saying exactly the same thing, and previously in his apartment saying, get your house in order. And maybe this is now where she's dealing with Fisk's emotional side, because again, she draws it out. Again, they've said the Russians were emotional, that Matt Murdock is emotional, and that's the weakness. And Gao is saying that he's becoming emotional as well.
Mm-hmm.
He has Vanessa. Or this crime syndicate sees emotion and that caring for a loved one as a pure and simple weakness that needs to be removed.
Yeah.
And maybe that it is Madame Gao with another kind of drug that's been laced through the champagne.
Yeah. And a really interesting point that you bring up is Owsley involved, because he does say, does anybody else need a drink as much as I do? And then he doesn't drink any of the drink. So,
Vanessa says she does. And then he's three big gulps. I was like, oh, God. Because her glass is half empty.
Mm-hmm.
And the one he drops, as you said, Johnny drops, it's nearly full.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which means, I took it to mean he hadn't touched it either.
Yeah.
It's not like he took a little bit, she took loads, and now she's sick.
Exactly.
It looked like he hadn't touched it.
It looks like he set them up.
But he was talking for that whole scene.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Absolutely.
So that's the bit I'm like, did he just get away with it because he's a bit of a loudmouth and likes the sound of his own voice?
He's just lucky.
Yeah.
And part of me was thinking, did he just do that so that suspicion doesn't fall on him, either he hasn't done anything, but because he hasn't drank anything, maybe he might be accused of something that he's not done, maybe something like that. One thing for me, though, is I do hope that Vanessa doesn't die from whatever it is that's causing the foaming. I really like her as a character, and it'd be a shame to lose that counterpoint to Fisk, actually. I do like their relationship. I like how it's kind of, it's very businesslike to an extent, but it makes sense for Fisk's character, and she's happy enough with that arrangement. So I hope she doesn't die, but he's got enough money, so I'm sure she'll go to a top hospital.
Or he'll find Vanessa 2.0.
I actually thought the first, they really looked like a couple in the last episode at the gallery.
Mm-hmm.
They looked like they were really together and happy for people to know they're together, and she's standing beside him in the press shoot, which is how Matt knows to go to the gallery in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
And now, if she's gone, it'll definitely be Fisk smash time if she's dead.
Absolutely. Fisk smash.
Absolutely. One point that stood out to me at the gallery was that we see essentially the group of villains, or the what you would normally see as the group of bad guys standing together for the first time. So you see Owsley, you see Vanessa, Fisk and Wesley all standing together for the first time, again, any other superhero show that you see that, there would be lots of laughter of the evil laugh, maniacal laugh variety.
Wait, let us tell us our secret plan to the world.
And it's such a testament to the show that now after 10 episodes, essentially, that you're looking at these guys as just another group that's in Hell's Kitchen. You don't look at them as maniacal bad guys. You look at them as, you know, the counterpoint to Matt Murdock. They're just interested to spend time with and interested to watch what's going on with their group rather than going, oh, God, that's the guy that murdered that person and did that person. They just seem like a normal group of people that are trying to do something for the city. Not that I'm empathizing yet with Fitz and Fisk.
I did actually wonder, though, the camera pans onto two groups of people as just after Wilson is talking.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm wondering, because it almost pans slightly too long. It focuses on two group.
Okay.
There's I don't know. We haven't introduced them. We haven't seen them before.
Right.
But one or two of them look kind of like comic book characters.
Right.
So I think probably not. But I would like to know that there may be more.
Right.
So these are Fisk's next army,
right?
But this is the political side of his army.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, we're gonna get some of the evil lawyers,
right?
The evil councilmen. Imagine Fisk for president.
Yeah,
like this is the way it looks like it's going.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, he does get the question as to whether he would run for Senate in future, and his answer,
I'll leave that to you.
There you go, good political answer there.
Is it Derek, what's one of your next points?
I'm gonna have to steal Rocks on Oil. From Chris. I know Chris likes to get all our Easter eggs in here, but Roxanne Oil is a really important company throughout the Marvel Cinematic Universe. I think, if I'm right, every single one of the 11 movies that have formed the Marvel Cinematic Universe of films, plus Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and probably Agent Carter, which we haven't seen over here yet, they have had at least one reference to Roxanne Oil throughout their running time. They've always had some. There's definitely Iron Man 3 had quite significant reference and overtones to Roxanne Oil. And in this episode, Roxanne Oil are the oil company that the worker who's clearly very sick and has gotten I guess some form of cancer or some serious medical problems. They're the ones that he's taken the court case against for working on the processing plant. It's basically the law firm that Matt and Foggy are working for just after they come out of college.
Landman so, Zach.
Yeah, and it essentially is what leads Matt and Foggy to leave that type of lawyering, I guess, and move in to do their own practice because they're seeing how evil law can be used, or how law can be used in a very evil way to shut out the little guy from having the opportunity to live their life out.
And I think it was very fitting that mm-hmm. this was Roxanne Industries,
mm-hmm.
by the way, not oil.
I know.
It's fitting. Roxanne are the evil corporation of the Marvel Universe. That's mm-hmm. who they are, back from the 40s in probably Agent Carter, but definitely in Captain America,
mm-hmm.
All the way up to present day MCU. They are that evil, faceless corporation. And it was fitting that they're the ones, when the Foggy and Murdock are in there, that this is the evil corporation that turns them and makes them go, oh no, we can't do this.
This is not what we want to do anymore.
And it was quite interesting that this was a toxic chemical lawsuit.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously, question mark, that will hang in the air forever. Was Roxanne evil chemicals, the chemicals that poor Matt was drenched in the very first episode?
Possibly being carried in Rand International's truck. Yeah.
There we go.
Possibly.
Yeah.
John, do you want to give us your next point?
Yeah, it's a small point. I mean, basically, I love the fact that Foggy calls out Matt's contradiction.
Mm.
It's, you know, the last episode, Matt is wrestling with his own kind of contradictions as well, with the priest. But this time, Foggy calls this out, that he's asking himself and Karen to use the law in pursuit of Wilson Fisk, yet all the time he is on the street not using the law.
Yeah.
And Matt does say that there are some things that the law can't help with, but Foggy still calls him out, saying, you're jury and now executioner. I almost said Judge Judy, an executioner from Hot Fuzz. It's that Peg and Frost movie. But I love that he calls out that contradiction of Matt, because it seems as though Matt's wrestling with that as well.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that was really good in these this kind of courtroom drama. He's cut through the argument that Matt is saying and said, you're just taking it upon yourself to be all these things, and there is no transparency to it, and there's no one to hold you to account. And it's a really good moment, I think, yeah, in that kind of courtroom drama scene.
Yeah, definitely. Just again, really good to see the argument between these two characters, and see Foggy bring up things that we've said about Matt a couple of times now, that stop telling them that they can't fight against this, but he's going out and fighting at night himself.
Yeah.
Irene, do you want to give us your final point?
I was just going to say, do we think the partnership is dead? We see Foggy dropping the sign into the bin at the end,
uh-huh,
and leaving the office. And he's already walked out on Matt, so it's like he maybe went to the office to collect something.
Mm-hmm.
So it's final, he's gone, he's out.
Yeah, I know. It does seem like, it seems like one of those comic book issue covers, this moment in this episode seems like the cover of an issue of the comic, which is, you're going to have to look for more, you're going to have to find out more by opening up, and it is where their partnership breaks apart, is what it seems like. I'm sure it's a reference, someone's going to have to know that, or I'm going to have to Google it. But yeah, it does seem like their partnership could be over now. Foggy was unrelenting in his accusations against Matt, and Matt was unrelenting in his apology. I didn't tell you.
But not sorry for what I'm doing. Not sorry for what I'm doing. Because trying to get him to understand, he can't do anything else other than what he's doing.
Exactly.
But
exactly.
Foggy isn't. No, he still seems very angry, actually. When even in the office, he's just still that stony set on his face.
Yeah.
I think this is going to be, I think it's the end of the partnership for now. I think within two episodes, something will have happened.
Yeah.
That Foggy comes around again. And
they can't not. They can't, yeah, break them apart forever.
Well, not for, it could be season two before they get back.
Yeah.
But I think this is the pivotal, coming up to the pivotal moment. So the pivot breaks them.
Mm-hmm.
Then something happens that causes Foggy to go, okay, Matt, maybe there is a way for both the law and your vigilantism to coincide.
Mm, yeah.
No, I think it is over. He's chucked the plaque in the bin. He's walked out on Matt, at least for this moment in time. It'll be interesting to see what potentially brings them back together, what horrific, bloody situation is going to finally allow Foggy to understand why Matt is doing this, and maybe even for Matt to understand that he can't simply carry this torch alone. I mean, to an extent, this almost seems a bit like a Bruce and Alfred Pennyworth type of thing. It is that Matt has not really had, other than maybe Claire Temple occasionally, but she has kind of not been in the episodes that much, really. Mm-hmm. Over the last three and four episodes. I mean, there was reference made to her that she stitched up his wounds in this one, but we've not seen her. So,
but I thought she was noticeable by her absence in this episode when Foggy specifically says she came over, fixed you up and left.
Yeah.
And it seemed like, well, why didn't we see the conversation between the two of them? But I presume it would have been just a very odd conversation, because she wasn't going to say anything to him about
anything at all. Finding him in the dumpster. She hadn't even told him that.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
We kind of...
Yes. I thought, wasn't she living with him still?
No. After the whole, I'm not going to fall in love, she's still there thing.
That's I just assumed, I didn't know, I assumed it was like, I'm not going to fall in love with you, but can I still stay here because the bad guys know where I live?
I think she went back to take care of her friend's cat. I think.
Oh, yes. But that they found her there.
I wonder whether then as well, Matt is able to use Foggy as his emotional crutch to share his secret identity with, so that it isn't as much of a burden as it is at the moment, given that Claire Temple, you know, seems to have removed herself from his life,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah. So I've just got one note about this episode for me. Just Matt's first fight, where he essentially dresses in an even more iconic outfit for me, which was his original Daredevil outfit from The Man Without Fear by Frank Miller, which is essentially just a bandana that covers just his eyes and he's wearing a hoodie. This is the first outfit that Daredevil ever dressed up in the comic book series that Frank Miller wrote. So I thought that was a great little moment to actually see the scene where he takes out the abusive father wearing this outfit. That was really good.
Yeah, and it was the striking running across the train, mm-hmm. the roof of the train, which that even reminded me of one of the pivotal kind of panels that you see a lot. If any of our listeners kind of Google that, it's him running across a rooftop. And again, mm-hmm. that's where I thought it was perfectly timed and perfectly kind of visualized.
Yeah, I loved the final wide shot of the railway bridge, the railway sidings, and him just stood over the knocked out body of this abusive father. I also did like the story build up to that as well, about the idea that as a kid he would hear the sirens and mm-hmm. make up stories about whether it's a fire engine, a cop car, or an ambulance, and that after the accident he realized how many more sirens there were in Hell's Kitchen and in New York City, and that something needed to be done. I thought that was kind of neat how they introduced this kind of backstory as well. Yeah. So that was great.
So if nobody has any other notes, Irene, do you defend this episode of Daredevil?
I mostly defend this episode of Daredevil. I think Foggy needs to cop on a bit in future episodes.
Right.
And hopefully at least start to see Matt's side.
Yeah.
And where he's coming from. But yes, I do defend this episode of Daredevil. It was just very sad. It's very down.
Chris, do you defend this episode of Daredevil?
Interesting. I'm really, it was some nice Easter eggs. So there was some nice kind of quotes back. It was plot exposition. Mm-hmm. It was really just, if any episode has ever felt like a filler, this was kind of it. It was an error to move the story along with 2 points.
Mm-hmm.
Well, 3 points. Foggy, yeah. The closure of the thing, Fisk and Vanessa, yeah. And poor Vanessa, we don't know. And then the showing of what we discussed, how manipulative Karen can be.
Mm-hmm.
And you could have really slotted those 3 scenes into one of the other episodes.
Yeah.
So, but I still enjoyed it. I'm enjoying the show. It's the only one that felt like a bit of a labor, so
right.
I'm a bit on the edge. I'm going to say guilty until proven innocent.
Right, right. John, do you defend this episode of Daredevil?
I'm along the same lines as Irene and Chris here. I just defend it. I was wondering what I would give this episode, and I was thinking 3.5 out of 5, but in the end I've gone with 3 tainted glasses of champagne out of 5. I think there's elements in here that I really enjoyed, particularly Foggy and Matt having their cathartic moments. I thought was really good.
Absolutely.
But I think that there were about 3 really just, I thought, dumb lines in here that maybe a continuation of long-running gags or jokes, but they didn't seem to fit in this episode because it was quite sad, it was quite reminiscent, and it was quite melancholy. Mm. And then the only other reason is I actually did like that, in a sense, they made Karen's character, for me at least, almost beyond the point where she can come back and redeem herself for me, that she is destructive, that she's obsessive, and she is only caring about herself. But, and I think the writers, if that's what they're going for the audience to not like the character, I think they're doing a really good job of that. But I did think that maybe it was a bit too on the nose for me, because I think she just looked cold and calculated, actually, by taking Benerick out there to the hospice where Fisk's mother is. That, to me, was maybe just too premeditated and slightly too much. Even though the reveal was great and really interesting, and I think it explodes an awful lot, I just wish they had pared back a bit from that for me. But there is a lot in this episode that I like. I've said the Foggy and Matt, and again, Wilson Fisk, Madame Gao, I mean, they are really, really good. And I'm looking forward to see how and if Madame Gao is behind that poisoning. I mean, mm-hmm. that is a good little cliffhanger here to end up on. But for me, three tainted glasses of champagne out of five. And Derek, did you defend this episode?
Yeah, very similar to you guys. It's difficult for these kind of episodes to give a review or give an opinion about whether I defend the individual episode. It's much easier for films where there's a start, middle, and end and a total structure of the story. For this episode, it probably has some of my favorite scenes. I think having Foggy versus Matt is a great thing to see. It's always interesting stuff when you read it in the comics. You know, the reveal of the secret identity of your superhero to his best friends is always something, you know, someone that didn't know about it is always something interesting to read and something interesting to watch. And I like they allowed that to breathe in this episode, definitely. Gao and Fisk is a fascinating time to watch two amazing actors on screen up against each other. It's always great to spend time with them. Having them all in the same episode, not so much. I will just say, with regards to the Karen element, I've been kind of a defender of Karen up to this point, and I feel that this episode is really probably the reason why it needed to feel as cold and premeditated. What she did by bringing Urich to the hospice, why it needed to feel so cold and premeditated, was because people like me are defending her. It hasn't stood out to me in the past that the character is this way, and now in this episode, it's absolutely standing out to me that she will do anything to get what she wants, and that's something I'd never thought of Karen before this episode. So, being a very revealing episode and having some great scenes in it, I do defend this episode as one of many. I certainly wouldn't recommend to sit down and watch this one and only this episode, definitely. Our feedback for this episode is on our Age of Ultron podcast, which we released last week. If you've now seen the film, you should have. If you've now seen the film, hopefully you've listened to our Age of Ultron spoiler cast. Just a couple of points that came in from our listeners for those episodes. Irene, do you want to give us our first piece of feedback?
Ben Rush sent us in. He said, "Send me a bottle of Jamie and some potatoes and I'll go again." So that was really good.
Yeah. Ben had sent some feedback that he didn't really like Age of Ultron, and we asked him to give it another go. But yeah, I think two IMAX tickets is about the same price as a bottle of Jameson and a couple of packs of potato, isn't it?
Yeah.
So maybe it's about the same price, to be honest. Rebecca Bradour also sent us some feedback. She says, "Ant-Man is actually the end of Phase 2, not the start of Phase 3. Really enjoying your podcast. Just wanted to point that out because it's kind of the linchpin for some of the random speculation about Ant-Man as to whether it finishes off this phase of Marvel films or whether it starts the next phase." So thanks very much, Rebecca. We did have a whole discussion about it that we did have to edit down a little bit. And we did actually get to that point in the end, but it didn't make the final cut in the episode. So our apologies for the confusion on that one.
It would have been bad. It was just myself and Derek arguing for about 10 minutes straight going, "No, you're right. No, you're wrong. No, you're right.
You're right, Chris."
Thank you.
That's how we argue. John.
Yeah, Rebecca also then sent in that Banner knows about Veronica. I think I had questioned, I'd kind of thought about whether Bruce Banner or the Hulk actually knew about the Hulk prison and the Hulkbuster Iron Man suit. And she's confirms here that Banner does know about Veronica, and when you watch it again, that he mentions that he helped, obviously, to build it and to create it. And so I promise I'd keep my ears and eyes peeled for Banner's reference to Veronica when we catch the film again. I think I did mention third time lucky. but yeah, no, it's there, all right. So, Rebecca, thank you for that spot. It's something I hadn't looked at or seen at all. And she did, however, she was very nice to say that there's no way I could have talked sensibly about Age of Ultron for 2 hours and not needed a lot more corrections. But corrections are all good. It means that we go and watch the movie again.
Absolutely. And thanks for saying you think we talked sensibly for 2 hours. It's very good of you. Our final piece of Age of Ultron feedback comes in from Rose. Thanks very much again, Rose. She says, "Hi, guys. What's up? I did enjoy Age of Ultron, but was kind of expecting more. I had the same feeling that it was way too confusing and there were so many important things happening at the same time. I thought it was a shame that the gemstones were treated so superficially." So these are the power gems, essentially. it's such a big deal, but Thor talks about it so casually. However, it was good entertainment for Friday evening. I thought I saw the barrels with chemical waste we saw on Daredevil, but it was a false alarm. she says, your podcast is amazing as always, and I love to hear all the team assembled. Thanks very much, Rose. Really good
Thank
to hear
you,
from
Rose.
You. Yeah, I think we talked about the gems in our Age of Ultron episode, and one of the elements that we thought was happening was that a lot of Thor's exposition was being cut out of the final film, that Joss Whedon, when he got into the final editing room, had edited some of these elements out. So the importance probably was lessened a little bit in this particular film. We'll see more of it in Ragnarok, and we'll definitely see more of it in Avengers Infinity War.
And director's cut.
And actually on that, it's been speculated this week that we will, in the Blu-ray, get the Avengers Age of Ultron extended, which is the director's cut, Mr. Whedon's cut, which is over 3 hours.
Very interesting.
Amazing. And additionally, we will get extra final scene or final credit scenes.
Excellent.
Wow. So this is one I'm going to be very hopeful for, because Josh has come out and said that he felt sometimes that he had to cut huge amounts out and that there was just too much going on.
Mm-hmm.
I actually think he's doing himself a disservice.
Mm.
I think Josh has a way of tying these, and I personally would have sat down and watched the 3-hour version.
Of course, yeah.
So, and I think most people who enjoyed the film will go back and watch this extended version.
Definitely.
Just on the gems, there was a reason, apparently. It started coming out in one. Josh has come out and said that he specifically did this and only teased elements of it for a specific reason, in that we will find out more in Thor Ragnarok,
right.
That he did not want to give too much to the gems and the Infinity Gauntlet.
Mm-hmm. Yep, no, totally understand that. Joss Whedon, the Peter Jackson of the Marvel Universe, basically, with his extended cuts coming out very soon. One final piece on Joss as we're in our feedback section. Okay, he didn't say it was for feedback for our podcast specifically, but he was being interviewed about Irene's question was asked to Joss Whedon as to where was Loki. And he did give a response that Loki, a scene was filmed with Tom Hiddleston, but was cut from the final edit of the film. So Irene, you were right to speculate as to why Loki wasn't in the film. The scene was filmed and was cut from the final version of the film. So maybe we'll see that on the Blu-ray in the end. So, good question, Irene. Thanks very much for that, Joss. So thanks very much for listening. Please send us your feedback on this episode or any other episode, or on the Avengers Age of Ultron to feedback@defenderstvpodcast.com.
Yeah, remember you can always listen to any of our podcasts at defenderstvpodcast.com/iTunes or search Defenders TV Podcast on any other good podcast catcher such as Stitcher or Player FM.
Don't forget to give us a review.
Comments as well can come through Twitter at DefendersCast or on our Facebook page or group. Just search Defenders TV Podcast.
So as always, thanks very much for listening.
Thanks for listening, everybody.
Defenders assemble next time.
Yeah, thank you so much for listening. Bye.
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 If we don't get a chance to talk, you take care of yourself.